but even like 5 years ago. I mean, it feels to me, I moved out to work with you in 2013. And I'd never seen a boom before. I mean, this is one of the things that was really important to me, is that being in academics, the academy had been in a depression since this change around 1972, 73. And seeing a boom and seeing people with like flowers and dollar signs in their eyes, you know, talking about a world of abundance and how everything was gonna be great. It seemed like everybody was the CEO or CTO of some tiny company. And then very, very quickly, it all started to change. And I felt like a lot of people moved back into the behemoths from their little startup having failed. A lot of the ideology felt poisonous. Like, don't be evil was not even something you could utter without somebody snickering behind your back. There's like a self-hating component where the engineers have been recruited ideologically and are like not actually there to do business. How did this happen so quickly?
Well, it's always,
am I wrong about this?
No, it's striking how fast it's happened. It's striking how much it's happened in the context of a bull market. So if you describe this in terms of psychology, you think that people be as angry in Silicon Valley as they are today. You know, the stock market must be down 40 or 50%. It's like the people in New York City were angry in 2009. They were angry at the banks. They hated themselves. But you know, the stock market was down 50, 60%. The banks had gotten obliterated. And that sort of makes sense psychologically. And the strange thing is that in terms of the macroeconomic indicators, the stock markets, the valuations of the larger companies, it's like way beyond the dot-com peaks of 2000 in all sorts of ways. But the mood is not like late 99, early 2000. It has this very different mood. And the way I would explain this is that for the people involved, it is sort of a look-ahead function. So it is, you know, yes, this is where things are going to be worth a lot more in 5 years, 10 years. And that's gotten a lot harder to tell. And so there's been growth, but people are unhappy and frustrated because they don't see that much growth going forward, even within tech, even within this world of bits, which had been, you know, very, very decoupled for such a long time.
Yeah. One of the things that's interesting to me is that when we talk like this, a lot of people are going to say, wow, that's a lot of gloom and doom. So much is changing. So much is better. And yet what I sense is that both you and I have an idea that we've lived our entire life in some sort of intellectual Truman Show where everything is kind of fake and something super exciting is about to happen. Do you share? Is that a fair telling?
Well, I think that there's been the potential to get back to the future for a long time. And you know, there have been breaks in this Truman Show at various points. There was a big break with 9/11. There was a big break with the 2008 crash. You know, you could say there's some sort of break with Brexit and Trump. And in the last few years, it's still like a little bit undecided what that all means. But I think there were a lot of reasons to question this and reassess this for some time. The reassessments never quite happened. But I would say, I think we're now at the point where this is really going to happen in the next, you know, 2 years to 5 years to decade. I don't think the Truman Show can keep going that much longer. You know, when I was, you know, again, I've been wrong about this.
Me too. No, I've been very wrong. I called it.
We had been off site when I was running PayPal in spring of 2001. You know, the NASDAQ had gone from 2000 to 5,000 back to 2000. Dot-com bubble was over. And I was explaining, you know, we're just batting down the hatches. At least one little company has survived. We're going to survive. But the sort of insanity that we saw in the dot-com years will never come back in the lifetimes of the people here. Because, you know, psychologically, you can't go that crazy again while you're still alive.
Right.
The 1920s didn't come back till maybe the 1980s or something.
So
generationally, was over. And yet, already in 2001, we had the incipient housing bubble. And somehow the show has kept going for 20 years.
Well, with the crazy narrative, like the whole narrative behind the Great Moderation. I mean, I remember just like clutching my head. How can you tell a story that we've banished volatility?
Yes, it's always, I always think of the 1990s narrative was the new economy and you lied about growth. And then the 2000s narrative was the Great Moderation and you lied about volatility. And maybe, you know, the 2010s one is a secular stagnation where you lie about the real interest rates because the other two don't work anymore. And sort of a complicated way these things connect. But yes, new economy sounded very bullish in the 90s. Great Moderation was still a reason to be long stocks, but sounds less bullish. And then secular stagnation in the Larry Summers forms, specifically what we're talking about, means, again, that you should be long the stock market. The stock market's going to keep going up because things are so stagnant, the real rates will stay low forever. So they are equally bullish narratives, although they sound less bullish over time.
So that effectively we need... What happened with the Roaring Twenties followed by the Depression was that there was a general skepticism. And here the skepticism seems to be specific to something different in each incarnation. You keep having bubbles with some lie you have yet to tell.
Yes, but I think, of course, I think the crazy cut on the 20s and 30s was that we didn't need to have as big of a crash. You could have probably done all sorts of intervention because the 1930s was still a period that was very healthy in terms of background scientific technological innovation. Just rattle off what was discovered in the 1930s that had real world practical things. It was the aviation industry got off the ground, the talkies and the movies got going. You had the plastics industry. You had the you had secondary oil recovery. You had household appliances got developed. And by 1939 there were three times as many people who had cars in the U.S. as in 1929. And so there was this crazy tailwind of scientific and technological progress that then somehow got, you know, badly mismanaged financially by, you know, whoever you blame the crash on. And so I think that's what actually happened in the 30s. And then we tried to sort of manage all these financial indicators much more precisely in recent decades, even though the tailwind wasn't there at all.
So let me focus you on two subjects that are important for trying to figure out the economy going forward. I'm very fond of perhaps overclaiming, but making a strong claim for physics, that physics gave us atomic devices and nuclear power and ended World War II definitively. It gave us the semiconductor, the World Wide Web, theoretical physicists invented molecular biology, the communications revolution. All of these things came out of physics. And you can make the argument that physics has been really underrated as powering the world economy. On the other hand, it's very strange to me that we had the three-dimensional structure of DNA in 53. We had the genetic code 10 years later. And we've had very little in the way of, let's say, gene therapy to show for all of our newfound knowledge. I have no doubt that we are learning all sorts of new things, to your point about specialization in biology. But the translation hasn't been anything like what I would have imagined for physics. So it feels like somehow we're in a new orchard and we're spending a lot of time exploring it, but we haven't found the low-hanging fruit in biology. We've kind of exhausted the physics orchard because what we found is so exotic that, you know, whether it's two black holes colliding or, you know, a third generation of matter or quark substructure, we haven't been able to use these things. Are we somehow between revolutions?
Well, I would say the question of what's going on, but I'd be pessimistic on physics generally, so that sort of would be my bias on that one. Biology, I continue to think we could be doing a lot more. We could be making a lot more progress. And you know, the pessimistic version is that biology is sometimes much harder than physics, and therefore it's been slower going. The more optimistic one is that the culture is just broken. We've had very talented people go into physics. You go into biology. If you're less talented, you know, sort of like you can sort of think of Darwinian terms. You can think of biology as a selection for people with bad math genes. And if you're good at math, you go into physics. You go to math or physics or at least chemistry. And biology is sort of selected for you know, all these people who are somewhat less talented. So that might be a cultural explanation for why it's been slower progress.
But I mean, we had people from physics. We had like Teller and Feynman and Crick. There's no shortage of, I mean, you know, to my earlier point, molecular biology anyway was really founded by physicists more than any other thing, I think. Why is it that in an era where physics is stagnating, we don't see these kind of minds? Like, I'm a little skeptical of that theory.
Well, I'm not so sure. Like, if you're a string theory person or even sort of an applied experimental physicist, yeah. I don't think you can that easily reboot into biology. I mean, these disciplines have gotten sort of more rigid. It's pretty hard to transfer from one area to another. When I was an undergraduate, you still had some, you know, older professors who were polymaths who knew a lot about a lot of different things.
Right.
This is I think the way one should really think of, you know, Watson and Crick or Feynman or, you know, or Teller. They were certainly world class in their field, but also like incredible in
they were highly
field.
Transgressive.
And you know, the cultural or institutional rule is no polymaths allowed. You know,
wow.
you can be narrowly specialized.
Yeah.
And if you're interested in other things, you better keep it to yourself and not tell people, because if you say that you're interested in computer science and also music or studying the Hebrew Bible, that must mean you're just not very serious about computer science.
Well, sorry, I totally want to riff on this point because I think you've hit the nail on the head. To my way of thinking, the key problem is, if you go back to our original contention, which is that there is something universally pathological about the stories that every institution predicated on growth has to tell about itself when things are not growing. The biggest danger is that somebody smart inside of the institution will start questioning things and speaking openly. And it seems like
the polymaths would be the people who could connect the dots and say, you know, there's not that much going on in my department. There's not much going on in this department over here. Not that much going on in this department over there. And those people are very, very dangerous. You know, one of my friends studied physics at Stanford in the late 90s. His advisor was this professor at Stanford, Bob Laughlin, who in the late 90s, brilliant physics guy. Late 90s, he gets a Nobel Prize in physics. And he suffers from the supreme delusion that now that he has a Nobel Prize, he has total academic freedom and he can do anything he wants to. And he decided to direct it at, I mean, there are all these areas you probably shouldn't go into. You shouldn't question climate science. You should all these things one should be careful about. But he went into an area far more dangerous than all of those. He was convinced that there were all these people in the university who were doing fake science, were wasting government money on fake research that was not really going. And he started by investigating other departments. He started with the biology department at Stanford University. And you can imagine this ended catastrophically for Professor Laughlin. You know, his graduate students couldn't get PhDs. He no longer got funding. Nobel Peace Prize, sorry, Nobel Prize in Physics, no protection whatsoever.
Yeah, Julian Schwinger fell out of favor with the physics community despite being held in its highest regard and having a Nobel Prize. And he used the epigram in a book where he wanted to redo quantum field theory around something called source theory. He said, if you can't join him, beat him. And I think it comes as a shock to all of these people that there's no level you can rise to in the field that allows you to question the assumptions of that field.
Right. It's like, you know, you're sort of proving yourself. You're getting your PhD. You're getting your tenured position. And at some point, you think that you've proven yourself and you can talk about the whole and not just the parts.
Right.
But you're never allowed to talk about more than the parts. You know, like the person in the university context, the core class of people who are supposed to talk about the whole.
Right.
I would say are university presidents, because they are presiding over the whole of the university and they should be able to speak to what the nature of the whole is, what sort of progress the whole is making, what is the health of the progress of the whole, and you know, we don't, you know, we certainly do not pick university presidents to think critically about these questions at all.
Well, I remember discussing with a president of a very highly regarded university. He came to me and said, can you explain how your friend Peter Thiel thinks? Because I just had a conversation with him and I could not convince him that the universities were doing fantastically in this university in particular. Like, how does he come to this conclusion? And I said, well, look, Peter doesn't come you know, with a PhD, but let me speak to you in your own language. I start going department by department, talking about the problems of stagnation. It was very clear that there was no previous experience with any kind of informed person making such an argument. I mean, this was a zero-day exploit.
But you know, in some sense, if you're a president of a university, you know, you should, you probably don't want to talk to people that dangerous. You want to avoid them and you don't want to have such disruptive thoughts because you have to, you know, convince the government or alumni or whoever to keep donating money that everything's wonderful and great. And I think one has to go back quite a long time to even identify any university presidents in the United States who said things that were distinctive or interesting or powerful. Well, you know, there was Larry Summers at Harvard, you know, a decade and a half ago, and tried to do like the most minuscule critiques imaginable and got, you know, crucified. But I don't think of Summers as a particularly revolutionary thinker.